Good morning. When it's your responsibility to get the podium and you forget to tell someone else to do it, it's still your responsibility to get the podium. We are continuing in our Matthew series this morning. And a couple things happened between last week's message and this week's message that it's important that I catch you up on in our story before we get started. And so Pastor Bob talked last week about the Last Supper, so the last dinner that Jesus ever spent with his closest followers. And he talked about how one of those 12, whose name was Judas, had betrayed Jesus and had sold him, more or less, was going to give him over to the religious leaders of their day for roughly just over $3,000 in our modern equivalent. And those religious leaders wanted Jesus dead because they were the power structure of the time. They had authority over people. And Jesus came preaching a gospel that said that they were not more important than other people. And so they wanted him dead. And Judas, one of Jesus' 12 closest friends, betrays him. And so after the supper that we talked about last week, all of the disciples and Jesus go to a garden and Jesus breaks off to pray. And then Judas comes with a crowd of people, a mob of people armed, and they arrest Jesus and they take him to the high priest's house. The high priest is the leader of the religious leaders that want to kill Jesus. And so they get there and they have a really interesting conversation, which we'll kind of come back to later. But at the end of that conversation, the religious leaders know that they want to execute Jesus. The problem is they don't have the power to do that. Because Israel, history lesson, Israel at this point is governed by the Roman Empire. And so the Roman Empire had taken away the authority to execute from the religious leaders of the Jews. And so in order to kill Jesus, the Jewish religious leaders had to get a Roman official to sign off on that execution. And that brings us to where we are going to pick up this morning, is with the religious leaders bringing Jesus to a Roman official for a trial. I'm a big fan of storytelling. I grew up loving fantasy novels. Because what happens with a story is you don't just have a play-by-play of facts. You have backstory and you have depth and you have emotion, and it makes something that, you know, your words on a page, it makes it pop. It makes it stick in your brain. And so this morning, I'm going to do kind of a different type of message. I have done this before, but I've never done it here. So this will be a real adventure for us to go on together. Some of you have heard the story that we're going to go through today many times, and some of you have never heard it. And I am going to tell it to you as a story. And so I've asked Amy to help me. She is going to read this passage in three sections. We've broken this into three parts. And at the end of each section, she'll read the verses in Matthew, but there are other gospels that tell this story. And truthfully, this is the crucible of all of the Bible. So there's so much depth and backstory to this story. So what's going to happen is Amy's going to read the verses, and then I am going to tell you the story in a way that hopefully it will stick in your mind. Make sense? And at the end of this, you will see that there is a question that we have to answer, and there's a question that we have to ask. And so this story is the trial of the Son of God. And we pick up with part one, which is Judas.
Early in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people made their plans how to have Jesus executed. So they bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said, "I have sinned, for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. The chief priests picked up the coins and said, "It is against the law to put this into the treasury, since it's blood money." So they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why it has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 pieces of silver, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me.
Enter Judas. Judas, who was one of the 12 people closest in the whole world to Jesus Christ. Judas, who was chosen by Jesus to be one of those 12 closest people. Judas, who has followed and been amazed by and laughed with and cried with Jesus for the last 3 years of his life. Judas, who Jesus broke bread with less than 12 hours ago. Judas, who betrayed his closest friend for just over $3,000. Judas, who sold him to the religious leaders that wanted to kill him. He saw money, he saw opportunity, and now he sees the cost. Because now he sees that he has placed the noose around the neck of the man who he has called teacher and followed for years. He sees that he has acted in hatred towards a man who taught him and retaught him what it means to love. He sees that he has condemned the innocent. And so he returns to the people who he was paid by, and he uses his words in this last ditch attempt to somehow remove from himself the guilt that he is feeling and to try to undo what he has done. He comes before wicked men and he says, "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood." But the story is already unfolding. The leaders have what they want in order to do what they want to do. And so Judas is left wallowing in guilt of betrayal, not redeemed and not rectified. He has repentance, but no belief for restoration or the potential of new life through this man whose death sentence he has written. If he had listened to his teacher's words, if he had only taken them to heart, he would know that there is hope even now, but he didn't. So instead of hope, he has ruin. And it's from a place of ruin that Judas withdraws to take a disgraced leave from the greatest narrative in the history of the world. And the commentator looks on and says, "Miserable is the case when a man must go to hell for ease." The money used in the betrayal is that will lead to an execution is used ironically to purchase a field for the dead. And with that, part one of our story closes and part two comes to introduce Jesus, bound by an unbreakable love for humanity and by the ropes of the hatred of men. He stands before the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate.
Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Jesus Barabbas. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he knew that it was out of self-interest that they handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting in the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask to free Barabbas and to have Jesus executed.
Enter into the story the man who the Bible says is the Son of God. The Word who was with God at the beginning of creation, through whom all things were made. The one who even the rocks would cry out to praise if people ever stopped. The only widely accepted person to have ever lived a perfect life on earth. The man who made it so that blind people could see and dead people could breathe in and breathe out. The man who touched lepers and didn't become sick, but instead transferred healing. One of his followers says of him, "If all of the things that he did were written down, I suppose even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written." Enter Jesus, standing with his hands tied together behind him by a rope, the fibers of which he created. Covered in bruises and saliva from the fists and the mouths of religious leaders of his time, men who were tasked with leading people to God and yet have come to hate God in the flesh. Because God in the flesh preaches a world where being more religious does not make you better than other people. Where being more religious makes you no better than a prostitute or a robber or an adulterer. And in fact, the Son of God comes and preaches a world where those people are welcomed in just by believing that he is who he says he is. And for men who spend their lives creating and protecting barriers between people and God, the mantra of the kingdom of heaven is near doesn't really work. So they've brought him here to stand in front of a Roman governor who doesn't care whether he lives or dies, whose only real interest is retaining his own political power. And so Pontius Pilate asks, "Are you the king of the Jews?" But what he means is, are you a political leader who is going to attempt to take my power away from me? This is a man standing in front of God, assuming that he has the upper hand. It drips irony. And all that Jesus says is, "You have said so." Because in fact, he is a king and he's the king. But he's not the king of a violent uprising against the government. If he was that kind of king, his followers could have attempted to stop him from being arrested at all, but they didn't, because he isn't. And so the onslaught continues. Allegations with no proof and no merit come flying from these religious leaders over and over and over again, and they're met with silence. The Son of God makes no claim. He doesn't reply. He doesn't defend himself. And in a room of men who are using their words as a mad scramble to gain or retain power, he's soundless. Can you see the confusion of the governor? He looks at one side of the room and he sees men who are tasked with upholding truth for their life's work, who have pledged their lives in service to the living God, and he watches them spew lies about a man that he can find no factual charge against. And then he looks to the other side of the room and sees a man who seems to be innocent and yet refuses to offer a defense for himself that could allow him to go free. And so here's where the governor will use his words again, and he'll use them in a clever way because he is not a fool, but he is a coward. And the choice before him is the coward's nightmare. On one hand, he has no desire to condemn an innocent man to death, and he fears Jesus, a man who is charged with claiming to be the Son of God, because what if that claim were true? Would this Roman governor execute the Son of God? Would he condemn him to death? And this fear is only reinforced by the urging of his wife, who says, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." So that's one hand. And on the other hand, he fears that making the right decision is going to make the wrong people angry. Protecting the innocent often comes with a cost from the wicked. And the governor is concerned for his own position of power with the people. And so, cleverly, in an attempt to remove from himself the responsibility of this choice, he speaks these words in front of the people, offering a release of one of two prisoners in the hope that the people will make the righteous choice that he's too afraid to make. "Which prisoner do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" The former, a murderer, a thief, a traitor. The latter, a carpenter, a healer, a teacher. And the second scene of the trial of the Son of God closes with this Roman governor sitting in his judge's seat and waiting for the people who he governs to absolve him from the responsibility of carrying out justice. But in the crowd, you can see the religious leaders who have moved from their position of accusation against Jesus, and they're walking amongst the people, and they're using their words once more to persuade the people that it's not justice that they need.
"Do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted even louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
Enter the people. Some of them have followed the story of Jesus for years. And some of them have actually followed the man himself. They've heard of or seen healings, the feeding of the masses, the raising of the dead. A week ago, people lined the streets as Jesus walked by and shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." It's been 7 days. Now, masses of people line the streets to determine the life or death of a man who is said to be the Son of God. Here is a man whose teachings have brought a promise of heaven to those who are poor in spirit, comfort to those who mourn, an inheritance to the meek, and a kingdom for those who are persecuted for believing in him. His has been a voice of love and compassion, a voice that has welcomed the lost into the love of God. But there is another voice, and it comes from the religious leaders and teachers who are walking among the people. And this is a voice that the people have heard for a long time. This is a voice that has told them what they are and what they are not. It's a voice that has told them that God is distant and they cannot come to him as they are, and surely this man cannot be the Son of God. These are the voices that win the attention and the decision of the people, the voices that they have heard over and over and over again. And so the people use their words for the first time in the trial story to scream for the crucifixion, the execution of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The governor stands in shock at this turn of event. His goal to absolve himself of responsibility to carry out justice has been met with a call from the masses for the blood of the innocent. This was not what he planned. He stammers out this question, what crime has he committed? But he's drowned out by the screams of people, calling for death by crucifixion, a tortured and painful spectacle designed to humiliate and cause suffering. And so the governor once more uses his last recorded words in Matthew as a final attempt to sidestep the decision that he was too afraid to make. He washes his hands in front of the people and he says, "I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your responsibility." Ironic to see a claim of guiltlessness from a man who allowed the fear of people to dictate his decision in a case of right and wrong. Ironic to see a claim of innocence that is actually a death sentence for the innocent. Sin is a weight that no one wants to carry, but we will gladly pass it off to someone else. The injustice is complete. The trial is over. There has been no accurate charge or facts. There's been no testimony that has stuck. There has only been wild accusations and cries for blood and silence from the innocent one condemned to die. And God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, is whipped and handed over to wicked men to be executed. So not exactly humanity at its best, right? The brutality and the injustice of the story, they leave us with this question that we have to answer, which is, in the face of being condemned by his own creation, while completely innocent, why would God not defend himself? Why does Matthew give us this trial account with no defense for Jesus? And to answer that question, we actually have to go back to a conversation that happened between Jesus and Caiaphas. Remember I said that before Jesus got to the Roman government, they took him to the high priest, the leader of religious leaders. This was the first place that Jesus was brought after he was arrested. And Caiaphas said, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." And this is what Jesus says in reply. This is Matthew 26. "You have said so," Jesus replied, "but I say to all of you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." And legitimately, when he says this, the high priest tears his clothes open. It seems like a strange response, but what Jesus knows and what the religious leaders know that sometimes we might miss is that this is actually a reference to an Old Testament scripture, a prophecy that is about the Messiah from the prophet Daniel. And Jesus knows the scriptures and the priests know the scriptures. And this is the claim that Jesus is making. This is Daniel chapter 7. "In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed." Since the fall of the Roman Empire that tried and executed Jesus, there have emerged 80 different empires, dynasties, and over 80 different empires, dynasties, and ruling structures throughout the world. But there is one kingdom that has not failed and has not faltered. And so this is why Jesus doesn't defend himself when we think he should, is because his focus is on a greater kingdom. You see, we're triggered at this story because it's injustice. And we see this innocent Jesus put through a false trial and found guilty of nothing. But Jesus knows that this is injustice in an earthly kingdom, in an earthly power structure. And this story is littered with people who are focused on either trying to absolve themselves of guilt and responsibility from people, or who are trying to gain and retain authority and power over other people. But Jesus has his focus on the fulfillment of a mission that was set into motion thousands of years earlier when Adam and Eve first sinned. And it will set people free from guilt. And it will remove from them the burdens of insecurity and selfishness that would drive them to want to oppress people. Jesus focuses on a kingdom that will welcome people. Because this will be a kingdom where liars and thieves and murderers and sexually immoral people and drunkards and potheads, people who are depressed and people who are anxious, will all come before this one king. And they will say, "Jesus is Lord." And they will find forgiveness and restoration that Judas did not find. This will be a kingdom that is not destined to fall with a political structure like Rome, because it's a kingdom not established by man, but a kingdom established by God. It's a kingdom where no religious person who has told you that you are not good enough to come to God can keep you away from a God who loves you so much that he would send his son to be falsely accused, tried, and executed just so that he could come to you. It's a kingdom where the Son of God will look out in a few short hours from the cross and say of the people who condemned him, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." So why doesn't God defend himself? Because he's in the middle of establishing a greater kingdom that we get to be part of. And this, and everything that we are going to talk about for the next few weeks, this is how that kingdom comes. The blood of an innocent God will be shed. And you, regardless of where you have been or what you have done, will be welcomed into that kingdom. I'm going to invite the worship team out. So I said there's a question that we have to answer at the end of the story, but the truth is that there's also a question that we have to ask at the end of the story. This Jesus, who doesn't defend himself when put on trial by the men that he created, this Jesus who allows himself to be executed by his own creation when he has legions of angels at his disposal that could save him at any moment, this Jesus who sees the corruption of an earthly political structure and chooses to create a kingdom based on love and grace and forgiveness at the cost of his own life. This Jesus who will carry the mistakes and failures of all of mankind on his shoulders and take them to a cross where he will breathe his last breath. This Jesus who had you in mind when he did that. Is Jesus worth your yes? See, this story is full of people who said no to Jesus. They did it for money, they did it out of fear of people, or they did it for a desire for power. But for you, is Jesus worth changing how you view your money? Is he worth making a difficult decision to do the right thing when you know that you are going to lose something by doing that? Is he worth standing up for people who cannot stand up for themselves? Is he worth welcoming those who have no home, or feeding those who have no food, or being a friend to someone who doesn't have a friend? Or how about being a friend to someone who's not easy to be a friend to? Is this Jesus who would do all of this for you? Is he worth changing your perspective on everything? Is he worth your yes? Let's pray together. Father, your love, is so deep and beautiful that truthfully we cannot understand or comprehend it. And yet you give us this tangible explanation, this tangible example, this tangible sacrifice of what it means to be loved by the God of the universe, and we say thank you for that, Lord. And I pray right now for anyone who is considering saying yes to this Jesus. I ask that you would bring the people around them to support them in this decision. I ask for anyone who is looking for a new way to say yes, whether that be through their money, or whether that be through their worship, or whether that be through their relationships and the way that they treat other people, Lord. Would you sustain them? Would you give us a desire to know this Jesus? We ask this in your name because we know we cannot do it on our own. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us?